Very pleased to be here as a one of the founding employees of the Schaeffer Center. I was very happy to see Leonard Schaeffer's comments. I agreed with literally everything he said. I guess the only difference between us is he's a bit too optimistic. I also agreed with everything that Doug Elmendorf said, and in fact, I've got two slides that I think very succinctly recap everything he said, and I'm sure he'll agree with this 100%. The fundamental problem with Obamacare is lack of cost containment. It's going to cost $2.3 trillion, not $1 trillion or $900 billion over 10 years. This has to do with things like accounting gimmicks that convert 6 years of Obamacare into a 10-year budget by delaying most implementation until 2014. It raids a half a trillion dollars out of the Medicare program, not to shore up the Medicare solvency problem, which, as was pointed out earlier, is a tens of trillions of dollars of unfunded liability, but rather to push on a new program with no cost containment whatsoever. There's only two things that I can think of that all economists across the political spectrum agree about. One is that if you want to solve the healthcare cost problem, you need to start taxing health insurance premiums. In addition, it would be better if we could move people out of being required to get their insurance through their employers. Obamacare doesn't even begin to start taxing Cadillac health insurance plans until 2018, and it's not clear that they're going to do it then. How do we know that? Well, just look at the doc fix. That's a $371 billion liability that each Congress pushes down the road for the next session. They're not willing to bite the bullet on that amount of money to pay doctors. And I doubt that when push comes to shove in 2018, they're going to start taxing labor union benefits and things like that. And to quote someone from the opposition, Paul Ryan, your own chief actuary at Medicare says we're bending the cost curve up, and we're going up $222 billion, adding more to the unsustainable fiscal situation that we have. It's my view that under Obamacare, insurance plans will continue to do the same old, same old. And the fundamental problem in health insurance is that 5% of any group of beneficiaries accounts for roughly 50% of healthcare costs. You basically have a skewed distribution, a log normal distribution for costs, or even more skewed than that. And so the easiest way to reduce health insurance costs or to improve your bottom line, your profits, is to select healthier patients rather than provide more efficient care. You can gain a lot more mileage that way than you can by trying to do the hard work of squeezing more efficiency out of the system and getting rid of unnecessary services or reducing unit costs. And this is a problem that Alan Entoven recognized decades ago, professor in the business school at Stanford, with his managed competition plan. And under that health insurance exchange, there were some pretty solid regulatory mechanisms put in place to try and deal with the adverse selection problem. I think that's a very tough nut to crack, and I'm not seeing that Obamacare is going to do that. The other problem is that Americans do not reward health plans for doing the right thing. And I think a perfect example of that is right here in California, Kaiser Permanente Healthcare Systems. If all of these innovations that have been discussed for integrated delivery systems and sharing information and bundling services and providing risk-appropriate reimbursement, if all those things made a big difference to the American consumer, Kaiser would have 90% of the California insurance market. They already do all that, and they have for the last 50 years. They're a fully integrated delivery system with all of the correct financial incentives for all of their providers. It's a staff model. They have had the longest experience and the most comprehensive electronic health record system in place. It's been in place now for several years. They have all kinds of sophisticated utilization review. They have intervention capabilities that are decades ahead of anything that's going to come down the pike through Obamacare. I guess we'll get into an argument about this, but Kaiser consistently outperforms. It provides better quality improvement and evidence-based medicine, better outcomes when every time it's studied. We just finished a study where we looked at rates of asthma, ED admissions, and in Kaiser, they are tenfold lower than national norms for asthma care. And they generally have lower premiums than the competition. In fact, there was a study a few years ago that showed that premiums at Kaiser, that is total cost per person in, for a Kaiser beneficiary, were already the same as the Canadian national health insurance, at least for some provinces. But Americans, well, some of them like Kaiser, but most don't. Most Americans do not want all this additional management structure. And we've already alluded to some of the issues about freedom of choice and culture and the fact that for whatever reason, Americans cling to the idea that if they can choose their own doctor, then that somehow magically is going to translate into better health care. That's not even an issue at Kaiser because you can choose your own doctor. They have to be, obviously be a Kaiser doc. But that's true of any network these days. You're sort of stuck with whatever network docs are available. So, you know, Kaiser is an example of why would you want to go through all that? They're not the most successful insurance company out there. There are only three ways to control costs. One is to cut benefits, and this would be true of public programs or private programs. This is already proceeding rapidly with higher deductibles, more coinsurance, more benefit caps. The second is to cut provider payments. We talked about unit cost, but this is also proceeding rapidly, certainly in this state. My own internist just left California because he can't make any money under his current reimbursement rates. There's a poll done recently that more than half of all California docs have considered leaving the state. I live out in the valley. We're already starting to get concierge primary care docs because the primary care reimbursement rates are so low that at least in certain areas along Ventura Boulevard, literally all the primary care docs don't accept insurance, Medicare or even private insurance. You want to go see them, you pay out of your own pocket. And it's probably worth it because if you can get good primary care and if something really bad happens to you, you do have your health net plan to fall back on. So it's sort of, major catastrophic illness just with another little twist. And all of this will be undoubtedly exacerbated by Obama's doubling of the Medi-Cal beneficiary eligibles in California, as well as some of these other states, and Medicaid, obviously, is the programs in the other states. So the third way to control costs is to eliminate unnecessary spending. And this is my nirvana as a health economist. I don't think the other two are the best ways to go. But there's a huge opportunity here. We currently spend $2.7 trillion on healthcare in the United States annually. One third of the spending is either harmful or useless. And that's a lot of money. That's $900 billion of potential savings. This is the size of the Obama stimulus plan every year. And I can go through a lot of specific examples. In the pharmaceutical area, we've got Nexium, which was one of the examples that we showed would cost more money in this country than it does in Europe. Why is anybody buying Nexium at all? It's exactly the same as generic omeprazole, and yet it's a $5 billion a year product because it's the purple pill, and it's marketed DTC. Avandia. There's been evidence now for years that it causes cardiovascular problems. This is a drug for diabetes. And in fact, the FDA just heavily restricted it about 3 weeks ago, and it's been banned in Europe. But it's another multi-billion dollar drug. How did it get there, despite all the evidence that's been available that it's not so good? Zetia, a cholesterol drug, again, $4 or $5 billion a year, absolutely no evidence that it's any better than generic simvastatin in every trial that's been done thus far. The bisphosphonates, multi-billion dollar class, Actonel, Fosamax, Beneva, these drugs are used to treat osteoporosis, but one of their big uses are for people that have something called osteopenia. There's no FDA indication for osteopenia. They've never been shown to do anything for osteopenia. And in fact, what is osteopenia? It was something that was invented in the basements of a large pharmaceutical company on the East Coast in New Jersey. And so again, there's no evidence, and yet billions of dollars are being spent on that. They also just got a black box warning because, ironically, a drug that you're taking to prevent fractures in your bones as you get older and your bones get brittle actually causes what? Fractures in your bones. Atypical antipsychotics, another multi-billion dollar class of medications that all the evidence says is no better than the older generic first generation antipsychotics. Diagnostics, the fastest growing area of healthcare, is exploded into $200 billion a year, and it's the Wild West in terms of what is known, when to do different types of diagnostic tests, MRIs, PET scans, CTs, and there's an enormous amount of money that could be saved there if people wanted to do it. And then surgical procedures, that's another huge problem. Billions of dollars could be cut with no negative effects. Medical errors are the fourth leading cause of death in the United States. 100,000 Americans die each year due to hospital-acquired infections. And still, many doctors and hospital workers don't even bother to wash their hands. Atul Gawande, a surgeon at Harvard, writes very eloquently in The New Yorker from time to time on some of these healthcare problems. And one of his classic articles is looking at the difference in cost for Medicare beneficiaries in McAllen, Texas, and El Paso. The bottom line is there's really no difference between the health of these people, their underlying characteristics. It's just the medical culture in terms of how many services they get. And of course, Jack Wenberg at Dartmouth has made a career of studying a lot of this variation. And you know, one thing is clear, if two similar people get very different rates of surgery or other medical interventions, and one costs a lot more than the other, and there's no evidence that it's doing anything, there's tremendous opportunity for savings. Obamacare is moving us in the wrong direction. You know, I'm a little skeptical that evidence-based medicine is going to save the day because it's not really a match for special interest politics. Again, every dollar you squeeze out of the system is a dollar that you're taking from some provider. Preserving the political sacred cows of prevention is an example that's actually built into the Obamacare law. And I don't know how many of you remember the controversy about mammograms that was occurring exactly at the time of the passage of Obamacare. And so rather than dealing with any of the evidence presented by the US prevention panel on mammograms, looking at the evidence that they presented, they went the other way and said, we will guarantee that every female over the age of 40 gets mammograms. There's even more evidence out today that suggests that some of that is questionable. PSA tests for prostate cancer, again, a multi-billion dollar industry, very little evidence that it does any good whatsoever. We're doing a study right now on colonoscopies versus sigmoidoscopies. Again, holy grail, everyone says screening for colorectal cancer is one of the best preventive things you can do. But using colonoscopies has not been shown to have any benefit whatsoever over some of the cheaper and less invasive methodologies. Flu vaccination for the elderly, again, billions of dollars, no scientific evidence. So why don't we know what works? Current institutions underprovide such data. Dr. David Eddy, who works for Kaiser, leading advocate of evidence-based medicine, estimates that the share of truly evidence-based medicine in the country, maybe as low as 15%. Insurance companies don't make money by being more efficient, and one of the big reasons for that is tax sheltering, as we've already said. Plans are often punished if they restrict care, even unnecessary care, rather than rewarded if they cut costs. And they seldom have enough market clout to actually implement evidence-based medicine guidelines or generate comparative effectiveness. My final point is sort of veers into the political territory. By cramming healthcare reform through without bipartisan support, the Obamacare has sort of set a path of, I think, wild gyrations. By making the insurance industry the whipping boy for all the failures of American medicine, if we can just squeeze down the salaries of a few CEOs, that'll solve the problem. It's sort of guaranteed that healthcare restrictions or reforms, no matter how sensible, will be characterized as government death panel attacks on individual freedom to choose healthcare. Where did the Tea Party start? In some of the open forum presentations about Obamacare. That's where the spark came for the Tea Parties. So the elephant in the room, what's going to happen on November 2nd? Well, the Republicans are now as free to be irresponsible about the enormous waste in the US healthcare system as the Democrats are in ignoring skyrocketing costs. And I think this is the real tragedy. We've politicized everything about healthcare, so anything you do to be try and rationally control healthcare costs is now a government death panel. And anything that you do to preserve Obamacare is seen as an irrational cost increase. So my forecast is that insurance plans will just simply hunker down as healthcare reform gyrates wildly between implementation and repeal, and it'll take at least, we've actually set healthcare reform back, I would say by at least a decade, before we get meaningful reform. Thank you.